Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of the program. Today we're going to go back to South Asia, Southeast Asia, more specifically Sri Lanka, and talk about these microlith tools that they found, which what the scientists are saying, all the researchers are saying, then there were people living there way further back than they thought. The excavation site is in this place called Fahien Cave. It's here in this part. Sri Lanka here. And what they had found up until then, and back in the 60s, they found burial sites in the area that were dated to about 33,000 years ago, and that's from radiocarbon dates circa the 60s. And they knew of these microlithic tools. They've had them. They found them in this cave. They dated these prehistoric fireplaces and this other organic material near the cave. So during that time, again, in the 60s, they thought that there were people living there right at 33,000 years ago. No further back than that. They just went, that was a hard evidence. Never mind the fact that the fireplaces were just there, and the tools were there 33,000 years ago. No mention of how they were carried there or anything like that. No mention of even the Ice Age when Sri Lanka was connected to India, which I did a couple of episodes on the past few weeks. Anyway, so they find these small stone tools, which again are probably arrowheads or spear tips, this type of technology that humans were capable of doing 50,000 years ago. Now, these are Homo sapiens too. These aren't any other kinds of humans. These are specifically Homo sapiens. They redid the radiocarbon dating on, well, not redid them, but on these oldest microliths in the area that they found them in, again, near this cave, and these are the dates that they found. The interesting thing about this is that they're older than not only everything in Asia and Eurasia, but even amongst the tools that they found in Europe, they're up there in age. They're not that far apart. So again, that is a big deal because scientists earlier, when they discovered these burials and these remains and the fact that they knew people were living in these caves in Sri Lanka 30,000 plus years ago, they wouldn't accept the fact that those people would have had technology before the Europeans of that time did. And it was a very Eurocentric type of thinking. Not unlike what we have now in terms of Denisovans and Neanderthals, although we're getting away from that. For the longest time, even now, biologists and archaeologists, anthropologists, they all agreed that cave people, there was no way that they had the capacities that we did. It's a very Homo sapiens-centric way to think. And again, we're seeing a very similar version of that, although on a smaller scale here. Until recently, rainforests were seen as barriers to human migration, with disease, dangerous animals, a scarcity of carbohydrate-rich plants, all limited resources, all posing challenges. So again, Sri Lanka is largely a rainforest. Very, very difficult to survive if you didn't have the right tools. But again, people were living here for 55,000 plus years, so they must have been doing something right. They must have been successful in some way. That also explains why research on human migration in Asia solely focus on the coast and savannah. They kind of disregarded the rainforest because they didn't think it was a viable place for people to live. It would be a waste of time and resources to look there. It's understandable why, but also very misguided, because now the biggest takeaway from this discovery is people, not only were they capable of living in the rainforest, they're capable of thriving there as well. So over the past decade, they've been gathering this evidence. And they're increasingly showing that Homo sapiens lived in tropical rainforests in South Asia, Southeast Asia, and Melanesia. Again, if we were to zoom out, like I said, we had the Kalao man from the Philippines and Homo luzonensis in the Philippines. It all makes sense that there are people, Melanesia, all over here, there are people living here, established. Or that magic number is about 55 to 60,000 years ago. And then I did an episode on the Australian stone monument, the oldest stone, quote, monument that they had, also dates back to this area. And there were people occupying the space back then. So it kind of seems like there were people living here all over, and not just Homo sapiens either. They know for sure that there are at least three other hominins living there, one of which is unknown. The other being the Denisovan, and the other being, not including Homo sapiens, but the other is the Hobbit people, Floresiensis. And then you mix the fact that before the last ice age, this was all a supercontinent, and it kind of makes more sense that, yeah, people, not only were they living here, they had similar technology, they had similar way of living, and they even have similar genetics. If you check out my last episode, it focused on the Tamil Nadu people, and a lot of the comments, again, they insist that there's been a long tradition that the people down here in South India are different from the people of North India in culturally, genetically, even linguistically. They're very insistent on that, and it seems like from the comments anyway that it's suppressed, that type of, for some reason, established academia doesn't want to acknowledge that fact. Although growing evidence that points to these people are distinct, and they're very similar to the other people as well. Technology, oh yeah, missing from this picture was a good understanding of of the technology humans used to survive. Again, they had these microliths, which again enable so many things in terms of survivability for humans. So again, people were living 50,000 years ago, and they were highly successful due in large part to these microliths. A very versatile tool to earn a basic living, to survive at least in the rainforest, and have offspring, viable offspring that take the same cultural practices, the same survival tactics, the same survival techniques, and pass them on until here we are now. So the discovery of a huge repository of microliths in the cave in Sri Lanka's evergreen rainforest piques the interest of these Max Planck Institute scientists. And then they did a four-year-long excavation, and they found almost 10,000 artifacts. And now they're finally being analyzed, and this is what they found. Some of the tools are 40 millimeters long. They were up to 48,000 years old, making them at least as old as similar tools associated with Homo sapiens in Europe. And again, we have this contemporaneous development of microliths and of these tools. So again, were they connected? How was it just parallel thinking? Or were both populations derived from an even more ancient population that had this technology in place already? The jury's still out. They say the sophisticated miniaturized tools used by the occupants of the Sri Lankan caves changed little over the long occupation, which ended only 4,000 years ago. So again, they were remarkably successful. They had this long, largely uninterrupted period of millennia where they were using this tool. And they know that because it's been found in different strata of the earth that spans a bunch of that time period. So the tools were there. The same tools, the same style of tool that were there 48,000 years ago were also found in the layer 4,000 years ago. And then from 4,000 years on, so that's about 2000 BC onward, that's when things started to change. And of course, that's right around when human history really starts to kick off. We start to have, recorded history anyway, really starts to kick off. And the rest is history, so to speak. In Europe and Africa, the earliest appearance of these types of stone tools is linked to hunting medium and large-sized animals in grassland or woodland settings, or as adaptations to risky environments during periods of climatic change. So again, a very versatile tool. It makes sense that they were both found in Europe and in Sri Lanka, although the environments were completely different. These microliths were made of quartz. They're speculated to have been used to hunt tree-dwelling prey and small mammals. That's because that's what was ubiquitous in the rainforest. The miniaturization of stone tool technology is seen as a major step in the development of tech such as the bow and arrow. And that's a logical step, right? The bow and arrow wouldn't come before the miniaturized stone points, I wouldn't think, because the stone point is a huge part of the arrowhead itself. I mean, it is the arrowhead. So it does make sense that if you were to look at it in a linear progression, just for the sake of demonstration, that the microlithic technology would come before bow and arrow technology. Again, this is a theory. It's not, that's not set in stone. For some, maybe bow and arrow came first, who knows, but I don't think logically speaking that we should say that. I think the safer assumption is that the microlithic technology came first. Researchers conclude that our ancestors were able to adapt their stone technology to the requirements of new environments, making microliths a flexible toolkit for Homo sapiens to spread out of Africa. Again, we're talking about Sri Lanka here. I think the author of the article, they still think that the people came from Africa to Sri Lanka, or they took a boat and just hugged the coast and got to Sri Lanka there, which would have been a peninsula in the pre-ice age in the Pleistocene. That's an interesting theory, and it is possible, because we see that in the Americas and the people of the Bering Strait. But again, you have a whole contingent of people and a whole perspective that doesn't believe in that side. Intriguingly, the idea that early humans in Sri Lanka could have produced microliths so long ago was first floated in the 80s, but it was overlooked because, again, like I said earlier, scientists did not believe, and they weren't willing to accept, that humans there in Sri Lanka could have produced such tools before European humans. And again, you can chalk that up to just being stubborn, or even if you want, you can call them racist if you want. I don't know. I wouldn't say go that far, but it's a very Eurocentric model, and I think that should be done away with. And just build. We should just focus on building a new paradigm, because obviously the old one doesn't make much sense. So yeah. Anyway, let me know what you guys think about this. About the people of Sri Lanka. Are there any cultural stories? And if you happen to live in Sri Lanka or live nearby or know a lot about it, are there any like local legends about the peopling of the island, or the origin stories of the natives there? Or if I happen to have overlooked some genetic data, do you have any links to articles that I can check out that has any implications as to where those genetics come from and how they're related to the rest of India? Yeah, let me know what you guys think, and I'll talk to you guys later.